mostly
yeah,
school.
Yeah.
You might have to change your...
I'll clean up in here one day. I had the heart. See, this is Ricky when he was one.
You oh my gosh. Details? Yeah.
So that's his dad, me and him, and then him by himself. And this is Ricky as a baby. He's like 4 weeks old here.
Aww.
So that's when that laugh was born. This is his chubby phase here. He grew out of that. So he started getting out of it, I think, at 12.
When I was talking to Ricky's mother and asking if I can make this film, I just knew that this was going to be hard for everyone. What was your favorite thing about Ricky the most?
Every day Ricky woke up, he'd tell me I'm beautiful. That was just his thing. Every day it was like he wanted to put a smile on your face. He wanted to make you happy. Your happiness meant more than his.
He was super fun, super excited about everything. I didn't see him upset until he opened up. Like, that's just the type of person he was.
He have no good, like, bad bone in him. Like, nothing bad.
He was like such a social person. Like, we just like clicked like right away.
Ooh, ooh, okay, okay.
He really didn't care who you were, what you look like. He just loved being around people.
He'd give you the shirt off his back. And I remember he got these new Jordans and he said one of his friends had some old shoes. And I was ready to give him my shoes. And I'm sitting there thinking, I paid for them shoes. You can't get them shoes. So we argued all the way from school to the house about you're not giving away them shoes. But that's just how big his heart was. I know a lot of people confided in him with a lot of things.
Me and him usually talk about sad stuff when I'm sad. But when he said, he just never opened up about it as much.
On the outside, he may be all fun and loving, but I knew something inside was hurt.
His smile hid like how he was actually feeling.
I knew, or I thought that if he had a problem with something, he would tell me.
When Ricky was 12, he had a friend that was talking about harming himself. Ricky was comforting him. And I'm like, oh, well, he should talk to this person. And Ricky said, no, I'm all he got. And that's when I thought, you can't be all somebody got at 12. And at that time, I could see a change in Ricky. Ricky always had these bright eyes. And like a little dimness came over it. I think after a while, it just built up on him.
He had told me he was suicidal before. And I asked him if he got help. He told me yes. And I just told him to promise me not to do that again.
I would always text, are you feeling high or are you feeling low? And he'd tell me if he had low feelings. And I'd be like, okay, I'm on my way home. We'll talk about it.
Like, every time he act like that, I gave him space. Because he always bounced back.
He just seemed very off. But it didn't seem off enough to ask. It just seemed like he was having a bad day and he didn't want to talk about it.
But Ricky go in therapy and be like, he cracking jokes in there with her. Ricky went there and talked about weather, football, but never got to the root of the problem.
Ricky made a group chat called People I Actually Trust. When I read the title, I felt like that was probably like a safe place. After a week, things went down. And I was watching a movie with my family, and then the group chat decides to go off again.
It was a black picture, nothing, just he's sorry, and then that's it. And then everyone in the group chat started panicking, and we're checking up on him.
People kept typing, why did he say I'm sorry? Okay, we need to take this seriously. Are you okay? What's wrong?
I caught him a ton, like, it's always go back to voicemail.
And so I called my boyfriend. I told him I don't know what to do. And he was like, I'm going to hang up. You need to call safe to tell.
Then I get a text and I just took off running. Got in the car and I probably did 100, 110 to get here. I got here. The entire street was closed off. I called my husband and I'm telling him the paramedics and EMTs are not in the house. So I know Rick is not with us. And he says, don't say that. I said, no, these are grown men out here crying in the front yard. Ricky shot himself.
I felt something that I shouldn't have felt, that something wasn't right anymore, that something was gone. I woke up that morning, and my dad had just told me someone at my school passed away. And I was like, I'm gonna see him my next class on Monday, and I'm gonna punch him in the arm and say, don't ever scare me like that again. I felt betrayed, and I felt pathetic that I couldn't do anything, that I couldn't make it in time.
I was thinking, like, what was the last thing I even said to him? I don't know if I said how much I cared about him or, like, just anything like that.
Yeah.
He sat right in front of me.
It just didn't feel real. People were crying, panic attacks, cops around the school, counselors monitoring everything. Our school kind of divided for a second. The only thing we united together was we knew that we weren't okay.
I got the message at 7:28. So it's like every night at 7:28, that's a hard time for me. So when I'm feeling down, I watch his videos, look at some pictures. But just knowing my baby, it was such a great kid, that gives me my strength. Every day I kiss his urn, go in his room, and feel that closeness. He's my kiddo. A big guy.
Yeah.
I remember I got him a bracelet and it had his name on it. Then he just, wrist got too big to wear. But he liked that, and he liked his little necklace around his neck. So before he took his life, he took his chain off and hung it up. And these are just some sympathy cards. This is a recording from the funeral home. You'll see Rohan Richard Broadbill. This is Ricky's picture from his vigil, celebration of his life.
That's such a good picture.
It's my one of my favorites. So I just got to decide where to put it.
Like, I didn't think that, like, something like that could happen to someone so close to me.
I literally was watching the news, and I saw it say that in the past decade, this generation suicidal rates have, like, increased a lot.
More people are more prone to talk about it now. Mental illness in itself was not talked about. Now, they're not hiding you. They're quicker to find a resource for you.
Like, we're probably going through the same stuff, and you have the same feelings that I am right now.
Getting it out there and making sure that there's a chance to save other people means a lot more than trying to keep it in for yourself.
Somebody on Twitter made the comment, I should hide my face because my son was weak. I'm not gonna stick my head in the sand or hide behind my doors and windows because my son killed himself. Because my sin, it could save someone else. It hurts me to the core that my son is not here, but I'm not gonna hide. That's not gonna help anybody else, and it's not gonna help me. And that's not a way to remember Ricky.
I don't know why he didn't come for us for help. I don't know what was taking over him. If Ricky is hearing this, I love him. and he is my friend. But it still hurts, and I miss him.